lovelies. So, welcome to Yin. Oh, I think we'll start with some seated meditations where I was aiming at earlier. Now, if you have a pillow or a stack of pillows or a blanket, anything that it's helpful, if it feels like your knees want to ride up too high or it just feels a little tender in the hip joints or the knee joints to sit comfortably, you're welcome to sit in any way that you like. If it's better to kneel and sit on your heels, you can certainly do that. That is a very common meditation posture in some circles. But just sitting up on the edge of a blanket, and the way that one of my restorative teachers, Judith Hansen Lassiter, she says that the best way to do this is to sit on the corner. And I've definitely tried it and I find it really interesting. So I'll show you what she means. So take your blanket and fold it and then turn it so that your sit bones kind of go and the corner goes up front. So you want to try that method. That's really interesting. Sometimes for me, just sitting right on the edge of a blanket is really interesting. So you can play with it and see which one you like best. The point of that is to get the hips and the hip sockets just a little higher than the knees, which is usually a little more comfortable if you're sitting in some cross-legged configuration as opposed to kneeling. Okay. Placing the palms down on the thighs, this is called the mudra of calm abiding. And that's one option. And then another option would be to place the palms up. You can even bring like the index finger or the middle finger or the ring finger or the pinky finger, whichever one you sort of feel intuitively the right one. They all have slightly different meanings if you look them up. You can bring one of those together. And the other option would be to place one palm inside the other and kind of rest them in the center. So you can have that option as well. And then just relax. I'm gonna take a few moments here. Do a little meditation. And by that I mean just arrive, slow down, take your sort of sensation of awareness, if you will, away from the front part of the brain and the backs of the eyes and kind of settle it a little more into this kind of intuitive center near the back of the brain. Feels a little bit to me like when you ease the seat back in the car or like ease back a recliner, like a little more relaxed, a little softer around the back of the eyes. Soften the throat, the back of the tongue, the upper palate, like everything that's involved in the sort of throat and mouth. That's the sort of beginning of the vagus nerve pathway. You can also kind of travel down right through the center channel of the body. You might know that as the location of the chakras or the seas of energy. There's a lot of different models for that. Just let yourself sort of settle in and release tension from the chest, the belly, the hips. To me, sometimes it just feels like sort of making myself a bridge between the earth and the sky. We're beginning our practice with this upper cauldron, this kind of positioning of our attention and awareness. Try to open that up a little bit, create a little bit of a connection, feeling of a little less mental activity, a little more deep wisdom. Another minute or so. During our practice, I'm going to release this mudra and give myself a moment. Our task during the practice is to keep this kind of upper chamber, this upper cauldron, upper sea of energy, these upper chakras, a little bit open, open to receive intuitive guidance about the poses and also just for you. If you need intuitive guidance, if you need a connection to spirit, if you feel like you want to kind of maintain some sense of that, then that's this kind of notion. So we're just going to keep the top of that a little bit open. So we're going to come down and focus for this next part. We're going to focus on this second cauldron, which is the kind of the rim of that is the collarbones, and the base of that is the solar plexus, right? So it's kind of navel area. So we're going to do some yoga poses in a second, but we'll start with just some movement, maybe rolling the shoulders around a little, or if it feels better, you can go like up and down, right, back and forth, rotate forward and back. Again, if we're kind of staying a little bit guided by intuition, play with it, and when you find something that feels right, go with it. Trust that. And this is a little way that we're, you know, connecting to that. We connect to it in bigger ways and other ways too. But little ways, little practices of connecting to our intuition can come up during our yoga practice. Okay. So with maybe a little bit less attention to the shoulders themselves, and maybe a little bit of sort of a little cat tuck and tilt, or maybe a little pelvic bowl tilt, and a little movement of the rib cage. Add a little bit more movement in. We're going to come up to the hands and knees, and you can keep this little movement going. The pose that we're going to do that's going to be held for a little while is called, some people call it puppy dog pose. It's kind of a variation on downward dog, hence puppy dog. And some people call it heart chakra pose. Sometimes I refer to it as shoulder torture pose. So depending on your concerns and your sensitivities and stiffness and whatever other issues might be sort of confronting you in this second cauldron area, I will take it step by step. We'll get into that shape in some way or other. You may want to have a pillow or a blanket that you can fold up handy. A yoga block would probably work also. barefoot. Let's do a few more of these little kinds of tucks and tilts, with the focus being on sort of loosening up the area between the collarbones and the navel. Just releasing any tension. Elbows to the ground and finding the place where it feels like the hips live pretty much over the knees. It may not be precisely over the knees, but pretty much over the knees. And the first possibility is just that. Stay propped up on the elbow, let your head drop forward, and the hips a little bit above the knees. The next possibility is to fill any gap that lives there with the pillow, and then lean into the pillow, stretching the arms a little further forward. You'll have to turn your head, probably. I don't even know if you can hear my voice because it's getting stuck in my armpit. But so that's the next possibility, is to fill in this gap between your chest and the floor. And then the last possibility is to extend the chest to the ground. Forehead will rest on the floor. Intense. So I'm going to fold one arm to put my forehead on and leave one arm extended. We'll do that for a minute and a half or so, and then I will do the other arm. If this pose just becomes way too much, child's pose is the alternative. Just go right into child's pose. Take two more breaths and then switch sides with my arms. Just shy of a minute left. You can either go back to child's pose or forward into like a crocodile or a sphinx, whatever you think is the better option.
I like to mostly just sort of melt into the map. Sometimes little windshield wipers feel nice to see those.
Is that we're going to go into a sphinx, which after the heart chakra pose, to me feels easier because that heart chakra pose or puppy dog pose, whatever you want to call it, ooh, that's intense. But if that's just feeling like too much, cross your forearms, either rest your chin or your forehead on your crossed arms. You can also, if you want to a little bit more, you can prop up onto your hands and do a seal. We'll stay with this guy for about 2 minutes. We're just focusing the attention on the ribs, on the kind of back of the shoulder. Might migrate into the lower back. Try to see if we can keep a little less sensation there. And a little more of the sensation on a kind of broadening or spreading out of the upper back. Which again, might mean lowering the pose down a bit. Sometimes that works better for me, or bringing the elbows further forward sometimes helps. Now we're gonna turn this into a frog when we're done. So give it just a little bit more time. The way we're going to deal with the frog today is we're going to break it into two halves of about 2 minutes each, and we'll put a little shoulder opener in between. So you could, instead of doing the full frog twice for the 2 minutes, you can do a half a frog, just do one leg. So I've got my knees taken out a little on the wide side. I shift my hips back. I'm going to use a little pillow to fill in the gap. Because it makes this pose way more doable. We're not trying to damage the groins or the inner thigh or the inner part of the knee. So you can point your toes in if that's helpful instead of pointing them out. We'll stay for about 2 minutes here. For me, it's a sort of an exercise in relaxing as deeply as possible. Given the intensity of the sensation.
longer here.
So I'm going to do two more breaths. And then with my next inhale, I'm going to pick up a little bit through my core and bring myself all the way forward here. Release the legs. And then I'm going to stick my right arm out to the side. And I'm going to take my left leg and just bring it around behind me for now. Kind of roll into that shoulder a little bit. So I am adjusting the shoulder. If for whatever reason this is not appropriate, there's a lot of reasons why it might not be, you can do a seated twist. You could do a seated shoulder opener where you bring your arms behind your back, sort of like a reverse prayer, but maybe only the one arm at a time. So you can substitute in some movements. Now I'm going to straighten out this leg rather than rest the foot on the floor, but you can leave the foot resting. And I use this hand like a little kickstand because I can't roll all the way onto my back and hold that steady. There are people I've seen who can lay on their arm completely. I cannot do that, and it is not appropriate for my shoulder. So I'm just trying to find this kind of stretch in the front and top of my shoulder without any numbness or tingling in the fingers. So I lean a little bit forward for sure. And this is just holding me up, just letting myself lean into it. I've got my palm up, that works best for me, and my elbow slightly bent, but you might want your arm all the way straight, you might want your palm turned down. So you can experiment a little bit. Stay for about another minute. Take two more breaths, and then we're going to come out of this by rolling, you know, out of the sensation. So I'm going to roll onto my belly, and then I'm going to give that shoulder a little gentle movement. Before I go back to the frog again, now, if you did the half frog last time, you're just going to switch which leg is flippered. You did the full frog, we're going back to the full frog. And settle in for a couple minutes. seconds. I'm gonna really gently release myself from this shape. Again, whatever way makes the most sense to you. It's gonna be okay. Maybe. It's intense. Alright, so then I'm gonna stick my left arm out and adjust. Take a big breath and then roll out of that side. And again, maybe give that arm some really gentle movement, that shoulder, or whatever you think is right. We're gonna come into a swan pose, which will sort of be our transition between this kind of upper body and the hips. Spend most of the rest of our time on our hips. So if you want, you can do your swan upside down, lying on your back, or you can prop one foot up, like lay on your back and prop one foot up on the wall or on, you know, table or something, and then put the other leg up on top. So you can do that. Use the things around you. I've got a pillow underneath my hips. I'm gonna do mine that way today, so that I'm a little elevated, it's a little kinder, because it's the first of these hip poses. I'm giving myself like a nice little soft place to land. Okay, so we're gonna stay with this guy for about 3 minutes, once we're all settled in. I've got myself propped up, so I'm sort of, you know, still in that back bending area. You could do that, or you could relax your torso more into what almost amounts more to a forward bend. You could even add a twist if you want. two more breaths. Now, I'm gonna bring my back leg all the way around for a twist. If you have in mind, like if you're doing a reclining version of the swan, you can always keep the reclining version of the twist. Now, I'm gonna sit cross-legged. This is my left leg, which was the one that was behind me. So I've got that up on top. And the twist can be just maybe a turning of the head or a little shifting of just the shoulders. Or you can, depending on your back and the, you know, various conditions of all the spinal vertebrae, you can let yourself kind of spiral from the this kind of top of this lower cauldron all the way through the center point, you know, this whole upper chamber here. And then you could leave the neck out of it or turn it the opposite direction. So there's some little choices that can be made with the twist. It can be the barest, like it could just be an idea of a twist rather than a physical twist, right? We're just finding a kind of space that feels a little bit like a container. It's just being drawn together a little bit. And the main thing for me, once I'm in the twist, is to relax as deeply as possible, because there are body parts now, like especially my shoulder blades, that feel like they're slightly out of alignment. So can I just relax through the shoulders? Maybe take a little bit of the pressure away from the lower back. And let the shoulders be the focus. Take two more breaths. And then we'll come around. I'll give myself a moment. Now, there's a couple possibilities with what could happen next. So, the first possibility is that the cross-legged, just regular sitting position is maintained, and you add to it a side bend. You can build that up so that there's places to land. This arm doesn't have to be over your head. It can stay down. You can make this into a forward bend, right? And then you can also begin to sort of stack the legs. So the legs can be stacked like that into the square pose, or the knees can come to the center into the shoelace, whatever's sort of available to your anatomy. I'm gonna do a modified version of the square where I use a block to rest my shin. So it's a little bit forward, but the thighs make that kind of square shape. And then I'm gonna hinge forward. So this becomes kind of all about this outer hip and outer thigh area for me. And that's kind of what we're aiming for, but whatever you feel is right. Sometimes it hits different people in different places. For me, the closer I get my knees into the center line, the more it targets this outer portion of the hip. You can do this version with one leg straight as well. So you could do like a half shoelace where one leg is over the top and one leg is straight. So if you want to explore that option, you can do that. And you'll just do the other side in the same way, but you know, opposite leg on top. All right, this guy is our longest pose. We're gonna stay for about 3 more minutes. I'm going to take a really big breath and let myself float up. And then I'm going to go really slow to unwind this pose, but just kind of unwind it gently. Now we're going to take about 2 minutes to do something. It could be movement. I'm going to stretch out like a giant starfish on the floor. It could be just sitting, if that feels better to you. Like, whatever you think is the right answer, is the right answer. Just kind of letting ourselves sort of feel the differences, maybe. We've done some things on one hemisphere of our body, like one hip has done some things the other hip hasn't yet. One leg might feel a little different than the other. It might just be that we feel, some little something that I've got this kind of interesting sensation in my right shoulder side of my neck that I didn't notice when I got started, but now I do. So there's a little release happening there, like that muscle is getting a little softer, relaxing, so I'm noticing some little movement happening in that area of my upper back. And this 2 minutes where we just get to do whatever we want or just lay still always goes by way faster than the 2 minutes in a pose. I don't know what that's about. We'll stay for just a wee bit longer. We'll take a couple more breaths. Now, if you were doing your swan on your back with the last round and you're on your back again, you're kind of primed to go right into your swan. I'm going to have to reorganize myself so I can get into my swan. Whatever you need to do will be just fine. Again, I'm going to use a pillow tonight. That's kind of structure. Sometimes I have to fiddle with exactly how to set myself up on a pillow. But it's there. It feels really nice. Okay, so we're going to stay with this guy for about 3 minutes. Once you settle in, it might be a little less. Oh, goodness. Relax a little more deeply now. We've been here for about a minute. Relax around the mouth if there's any tension there. We're kind of still trying to keep that sort of sense of relaxing into the back body, even though we might be feeling a lot more kind of pull towards the front of the body. do about three more breaths. I'm going to come out of here and into the twist, taking your time. Up again, I'm doing a really simple just cross-legged position, but you can have this knee up for your twist. Your twist can be a little more oriented just towards a turning of the head. My focus is always this kind of middle area, right? This middle chamber, middle cauldron. Longer. Two more breaths. Just unwind the twist, and then you can maneuver your way into whatever your second half of this shape is. You did the shoelace or the square or some variation of the two. One of the two, a half a shoelace. Whatever you did. We'll stay for about 4 minutes here all together. So this, we're moving into summer. It's definitely summer here this week. and summer in Chinese medicine is the lung and large intestine. And then we'll also visit the heart as we get later into the summer. So we're kind of dealing with this kind of shoulder girdle, chest, upper back. That's the kind of chamber that contains the lungs. The meridians run through the arms from the thumb and index finger up either side of the arm and through the shoulder. So these poses where we kind of play with the shoulders or we play with the upper back. That sort of area, those are all sort of, touching into the meridian pathways there. Of course, yin generally focuses more on the hips, but just throw in the little flavor for summertime with the upper body. about halfway through. More breaths. I'm going to go ahead and come all the way up and lean back a little bit and really gently unwind everything. Now this time I'm just going to hang out in this seated position, give myself a little jiggly movement. You can go back to lying down if you want. So the Chinese system, in addition to the kind of meridians that feed the organs and there are other meridians as well, they also kind of envision these sort of places where qi sort of collects together, and they have like three sea of energy locations. So the upper sea of energy is this the skull, right? Then there's a center sea of energy that kind of orients around the heart, and then there's a lower sea of energy which kind of orients around the navel center. The yogis from India envisioned these seven different energy centers that we know as the chakras, right? So those are, you know, if you overlap the systems, there's some interesting places where they meet up and then some places where they diverge. And then the system that I'm working with right now, just as a kind of exploration, actually comes from Celtic mythology, and it's similar to the Chinese system. There's this notion of these three energy centers, and they're cauldrons. And so the upper cauldron, the base of the cauldron, the little footy parts, is the throat, and then the rim of the upper cauldron lives just above the top of the crown of the head. And so the center cauldron, the rim of the cauldron lives here at the top of the shoulders, collarbones, and then the base of the cauldron is the navel center. So can you envision kind of that, a little bubbling pot of soup living in this area? And then the lower cauldron, kind of the top of the sacrum, the rim of the pelvis, just below the navel, and then the root of the cauldron is somewhere, it depends on whether you're a male or female, I think it's different, but the root of the cauldron is somewhere in the, you know, lower body. It could be the pelvic floor, it could be some other points. In any case, if we work with that notion, then we've kind of explored this center cauldron in some of the poses we've done. We've explored this upper cauldron through our attention to relaxing and remaining sort of steady. So this lower cauldron we've explored a little bit through some poses. We're going to kind of focus on that energy as well with one more set of poses. So we're going to take the legs out wide. Now, for some folks, just the genetics of this, the pelvis tilts backwards. So there's a number of options. One is don't go so wide, right? The legs can be a little closer together. Second option is to bend at the knee and fill in this gap with a blanket. I put a little blanket under my knee gap, but pillows could go in there. You can also elevate the hips so you sit up a little higher and see how that works, especially right on the edge or on the corner of the blanket. That might work better. All right, so we're gonna start with turning toward one leg and folding over it. If you wanna bend the other leg, you can. We're gonna do 2 minutes here, 2 minutes in the middle, 2 minutes over the other side, and 2 more minutes right in the center. So we'll wind up with quite a few minutes when it's all said and done. So work, act appropriately. If you want this knee bent, bend that knee. So now what I'm, you know, kind of focusing my attention on, physical sensation-wise, is how one kind of outer part of my hip and the connecting, you know, orientation around this kind of lower back, top rim of the pelvis, sacrum, feels compared to the other side. I'm trying to soften into this area, so I'm not tugging on it with a great deal of force, but more sort of releasing and encouraging a sense of movement or hydration in this area. Can we work at that level with the practice rather than at some sort of like, oh, I'm gonna force myself to an edge? What happens if we soften the whole approach? Myself up and then go right down the center line. And this might mean sitting upright rather than folding forward. It might be the better option. Shifting to the center, all this extra sensation down this side from the kind of gentle pull of it. Now everything's kind of reorienting to the middle. Just noting that movement. you've had the one leg bent, then you're going to switch at this point. So we're going to come up and then we'll go over the opposite leg again. You might decide that you want this opposite knee bent. It's fine. Part of the exploration for me too here is, you know, how does the one sit bone root into the earth or pull away from it, depending on the angles of the pose? Am I intentionally pulling? Can I stay rooted and let the kind of gentle release happen without my, you know, intending it? It's more like allowing than intending. I don't know if that makes sense or not, but hopefully it does. And then one more time, we're going straight down the center. This is the last of this, this arrangement. And it's me part of the exploration of this lower energy center is like, what happens when I tilt it to the side or forward or back? Both to the physical structure, like the muscles that I feel, the joints in the area that I, you know, the joints in the sacrum, the joints of the lower spine, the joints of the hip socket. And then the pelvis itself has little joints at the pubic bone. There's little movement in each wing of the pelvis that changes a little bit. Adjust. It's not a big adjustment. It's not like the femur bone hip socket adjustment, but there's ever so slightly a little bit of give on either wing of the pelvis. And we kind of become aware of the dynamism, if that's the right word, of the pelvis itself. We'll stay for about 5 more breaths, about 30 more seconds. Breath, hold it in. And unfurl, uncurl, lean back, bend my knees. Ugh, swing my legs to the middle. Now we're gonna decide on an ending for ourselves. The ending could be like legs up the wall or legs over the couch or legs on a chair. I'm gonna do a reclining butterfly with a ton of support, so it kind of leans into the restorative end of the spectrum. But you could do just a shavasana, just a corpse pose also. Take about the next minute or so to meander into this this butterfly shape. Maybe a little bit of windshield wipery, happy baby to get there. Place you choose, whatever pose you choose, just let yourself again sort of settle deeply into the body, rest deeply both with your attention and physically let every muscle get as soft as possible. I'll stay with this guy for about 5 minutes or so. gently just bring your attention back to your breath. Not going anywhere yet, but just noticing the rise and fall of the navel or the ribs. Big breath all the way to your tiptoes. Let it go with a sigh. Then you can start to stretch and move and wiggle around and eventually come to a seated position. For joining me for some yin yoga tonight. Let's take a big breath together. Nice big inhale. And a sigh. And blessings to you for your night. Namaste.